Thank you for inviting me to talk a little bit about these techniques' effectiveness in the context of where kids are developmentally at the time that they are being interrogated. And I want to start with just two quick little summaries to make it clear that these techniques are very effective not just in getting false confessions, but for kids who give factual statements that then end up in court being used against them. So two quick examples. One is of a 15-year-old girl named Elise who was in a violent dating relationship with a young man who was 18, who she trusted very much, was in love with. And unbeknownst to her, he was using meth. And one day, while he was high, concocted the idea that they would run off together, which she did not want to do. And then unexpectedly, when her mother arrived home from work, killed her mother in front of Elise. He then, using his knife to threaten her, told her to get her mother's keys, her mother's wallet, and drive the two of them to the ATM machine, where they withdrew as much money as she could, and then she and he drove out of state with her driving. When they were arrested, they were, of course, separated from each other in interrogation. And the police officer, using these techniques, but in a really very successful way with a 15-year-old girl, just asked her to tell him what had happened to her mother. So she picked up on that cue that what she was supposed to do is just say the basics of what her boyfriend had done, which she did. She described what he did, not knowing even then that he was high on meth. And at no point did she do anything other than describe what her boyfriend did. She didn't talk about being scared, and the officer said repeatedly, let's not talk about your feelings. You just tell me how the car got out of state and what happened to your mother. So at the end of her giving this this outline of what he did, they arrested her, telling her that her boyfriend had told them that this whole plan was hers. She was in conflict with her mother. She had to run away from home. The only way she could run away from home would be if he killed her mother. When I asked her, why in your interrogation didn't you start with being kidnapped? Why don't you explain the bigger story, which was that you were forced to put the keys in your mother's car. You were forced, with a knife being held to you, to go to the ATM machine. The knife doesn't show in the ATM video, but nonetheless, why didn't you talk about being forced to drive the car? She said, kidnapped? Isn't that what people do with children? I mean, isn't that like they duct tape a child's hands or put them in the trunk of a car? It immediately occurred to her that given her the domestic violence that she was experiencing and had grown up with in her household, that what was done to her that day was kidnapping. And there was never a kidnapping perspective put on what happened until she was in an adult trial where ultimately she was acquitted by the jury. Her statement was factual. She was there when her mother was killed by her boyfriend. It wasn't a false confession. She only confessed to being present, she thought, except in the context of his statement that she was the mastermind, he at 20 and she at 15. On its face, a pretty unlikely story, wouldn't you think? The second example that I want to give you briefly is of a false confession. of a 16-year-old boy named Omar, who was at his friend's house playing video games and watching TV. They fell asleep and were awakened by the police banging on his friend's door. Omar was taken into custody. It turned out that his ex-girlfriend's apartment building had just burned down, killing two elderly residents who were unable to get out of the building. And his ex-girlfriend, who had, was very furious with him on that particular day, unfortunately, said that she was sure he had done it and that she thought that she saw him that night. The police used this technique brilliantly. He was interrogated for many hours, starting in the middle of the night. They told him the whole story of how they had evidence that he had been the one who took a plastic milk jug to a nearby gas station and filled it up, that they had the person who was the attendant at the gas station had ID'd him with a picture, and that jug with his fingerprints on it, a plastic milk jug with his fingerprints on it, had been found at the scene. And then lastly, they used a fake technique that was the final thing that broke him down, which was that they said, if you put your hands on this copier machine, any gasoline residue will show up in the copy as dark gray. And unfortunately, he wasn't one of these kids who'd gone to the office with a parent and had repeatedly, as some of you may have done, put your hand on a copier machine just so you can walk out with a copy of your hand. So he honestly had never done that. Lo and behold, there was his handprint that came out covered with gray gasoline residue. Feeling utterly hopeless, utterly unable to get out of that convincing evidence of his guilt, he signed a very brief statement with the idea that he just had to get out of the police station so that he could get some help. And he was found guilty of his offense, which wasn't an offense at all, but something that he falsely confessed to at 16 and went to adult prison until he was found to have falsely confessed. These two teenagers, one of whom gave a factual statement, the other of whom gave a false confession as a result of police interrogation, had interrogation that took advantage of where these two kids were developmentally. And the important things to recognize about where they were developmentally is to see that their teenage thinking, which is the result of incomplete brain development at 15 and 16, results in not being able to anticipate the worst consequences of signing a statement. And also preys on two other characteristics of many of the kids who are prosecuted in juveniles, who are prosecuted in juvenile or adult court, and that is their learning disabilities and their past trauma. And so it's the technique in combination with the immature thinking of the teenager and their disabilities and trauma in many cases that results in statements that are given often very quickly and a few hours after the offense, as was true for both Elise and Omar. Your point that it should follow investigation is an important one. Both of these kids were being interrogated very, very soon after the murders had occurred. So let me give you a little cheat sheet on a developmental framework that you can rely on for lots of other aspects of juvenile cases, of course, but particularly understanding police questioning. And this will be available to you so that you can make use of this outline at another point, should you want to. And I'm sorry, it's pretty illegible up here, so let me just walk you through the immature thinking of teenagers and how it would affect them in police questioning. And a couple of things that are important to remember. Where teenagers are in their development of thinking abilities is that they have a great deal of difficulty. This is universally true for smart students as well as other teenagers. They have great difficulty anticipating what's going to happen next. They very often simply don't think about the worst thing that could happen. They often minimize risk. And that's a characteristic of teenagers that's been recognized in the three recent Supreme Court cases, Roper, Graham, and Miller. So it's a widely accepted fact of psychological research that teenagers take risks as part of their job in growing up. And the only way they could take those risks would be if they couldn't think ahead to what's the worst thing that could happen. They're often unable to see any other choice. So this isn't just true in the police station. This is true in life when they lose a basketball game and get involved in some kind of a group event that ends up very negatively for someone. They do that without seeing that they had a choice to walk away, for example. And why? Because they're teenagers and they don't have much of a repertoire of decision-making skills. They often also have an immature identity, an unformed identity, which results in their wanting acceptance from peers, but also from adults. They're having great difficulty being able to stand up against pressure from anyone. Again, not just well-known peer pressure, but their challenge in being able to stand up to any. You're pulling my microphone cord. Let's see if we can compromise here. It's just wrapped up on the yellow extension cord. That's okay. So how do these, how does this immature thinking play out during police questioning? Well, first, and this goes back to their difficulty really getting what Miranda means, most teenagers that I have interviewed could not look ahead to see the statement in court. They are shocked when I do my evaluation and I pull out their written statement and they say, "Where did you get that?" And then when they learn that the judge is going to have that piece of paper that they signed in the police station, thinking, as I told you Omar did, I just have to get out of here. I'll just write my name on this thing, and then it'll get worked out later. They're shocked that that piece of paper is going to appear again, and they have no concept whatsoever of the significance of that piece of paper in their case. They can't see the magnitude of the situation, even in Elise and Omar's cases where homicide is ultimately what they're being charged with. They didn't do it, so they can't really get it at the time, and that's all because of their immature thinking doesn't permit that big a picture. Frequently, teenagers get in a situation where the narrowness of their thinking in during police questioning boils down to, the only way I'll get out of here is if I do what the police officer is asking me to do. I'm not going to get to pee. I'm not going to go back to bed if it's the middle of the night. I'm not going to get any food, and I'm and I'm not going to go home unless I just sign this piece of paper. And although you said they're not allowed to make false promises about not being prosecuted, certainly police officers are allowed, and frequently do, make clear implied statements of, we just got to get this little technicality out of the way, and your man is just waiting right out there. Now, maybe the police officer doesn't say, and you are going home with your mom, but I've watched so many of these videos where it's clear that that's what the kid thinks, that you just got to get over this little thing called signing this piece of paper, and then you're going to be able to go home. Now, of course, no one in this room would ever think that. But for a teenager who's got this very limited way of thinking, and has minimized risk, they don't see any dangers in signing this little piece of paper, and they see a lot of immediate gain for them in just getting out of that room and going home. Lastly, immature thinking really backfires for teenagers because they make the assumption that they can take back what they said. And they not only don't know the significance of their statement, they don't realize that once done, it cannot be taken back. Because of their immature identity, they also are very easily hurt by anything rejecting that happens between them and the police officer, believe it or not. So being called a liar, as Omar was, over and over and over, the pages of this transcript of the police officer actually saying in a sing-songy way, lying, liar, lying, liar, about hundreds of times. And for a kid with an immature identity, it is not possible for them to be able to withstand hours of someone demeaning them in that way. They are also typically very unsure of themselves. So after a while, as happened in the Crow case, as happened with Omar, they start to really wonder about themselves and whether it was possible that maybe they did this and they just weren't all there at the time. In addition, being 16, many teenagers are still pretty compliant. They are typically being spending all their time in school and at home being told they should do what adults tell them to do. Often, they are not able to stand up to the police, even when what they're being asked to sign or the questions that they are being asked make it clear that the police officer believes that they did something that they didn't do or that didn't go down in the way the police officer is presenting it. Simply standing up and saying, no, I am not going to answer any more questions is not something I have ever seen a kid do in any video or in any transcript of police interrogation. The naivete that you see in teenagers during interrogation might be hard to believe, but it is really appropriate for their age. They, even kids who grow up in dangerous streets where they don't see the police officers being friendly to adults, most of them still believe that the police officer is supposed to help you. And you have to remember that where teenagers are in the development of their morality is that they still believe in right and wrong. And so most teenagers are incredibly upset when they learn that the police officer lied during the interrogation. They believe in the police. They believe that police officers, as one kid told me, aren't they like preachers? I mean, they're supposed to be better human beings than the rest of us. So they wouldn't lie about evidence, about fingerprints, about the handprint on a copier machine. And they are morally outraged when they learn they've been lied to. And that naivete really is a huge factor that that we have to recognize is part of what happens during interrogation. Let me just cover these two other aspects of the developmental framework, which you can then use as a cheat sheet in the future if you choose. The first is that at least 50% of juveniles who are arrested have significant learning disabilities. And two of them particularly interfere with good comprehension during police interrogation. The first is a lot of what's called expressive and receptive language disorders, very typical of kids that that we see in juveniles who we see arrested. That means they don't digest information, they don't comprehend questions in a normal way. And this disability may or may not have been recognized. They may or may not have an IEP for special instruction, but their comprehension problems means that you'll often see them on the videotape saying, huh? Or they simply don't let the officer know. They have no idea what the officer just said. They just, lots of Miranda, for example, videotapes, the kid says, uh-huh. Do you understand this and this is, uh-huh. And you get no sense at all that there is real comprehension. And then testing later can demonstrate how little they comprehend when adults are talking to them. In addition, many teenagers also have what's called executive function disorders, and these are responsible for lots of learning difficulties. Now, that is my phone, which I turned off, but it does sing like a bird, I'm sorry. Evidently, I didn't turn it off. The way that executive function problems really get in the way with police interrogation is that these are kids who have a lot of trouble telling a narrative in the order that the events happened. And that doesn't just have to be a stressful story, but any story. If you ask them how was the movie that they just saw, the narrative that they tell is not in the order of the movie. And this is one of the many organizational problems that their brains have that are classified under executive function. These two characteristics are very typical of kids in foster care whose mothers abuse substances during pregnancy. They are also characteristics of kids with TBI, traumatic brain injury, which may not have been recognized when they were physically abused or when they experienced brain trauma, being beaten up on the street. And many of them have not had special education services. But when they're going through police questioning, even if they have high intelligence, they may have learning disabilities that impair their ability to understand the questions that they are asked. I don't want to fail to mention the kids who have low IQ or very low reading scores, who don't read because they can't read their statement, and who frequently do not have the statement read out loud to them before they sign it. They just sign it, even though they may be reading at the second grade level. Lastly, of course, past trauma, physical and sexual abuse, major losses, exposure to domestic violence and other violence is true of the majority of teenagers who are arrested. And for them, trauma affects their behavior every day. But it particularly affects them during police interrogation because they are very reactive to threat. They are easily scared, especially in a two-on-one. So the bad cop, good cop doesn't really have to be much of a bad cop. Just being with two adult police officers is enough to frighten a traumatized teenager. They've also been through the trauma of their arrest, and very often through the trauma of the offense itself. So they are not functioning well because of what they've just experienced. They often cry, as you saw in the videotape, for hours through the offense. Impossible to tell whether this child is crying because his sister is dead, and he was there when her body was discovered, and how much he was crying because a police officer was interrogating him in the way that they did. This kind of terror leads to teenagers being quickly overwhelmed and just wanting to get away from the situation that is triggering old memories of trauma or is overwhelming because of what they've just been through. Finally, I just want to mention that traumatized teenagers often abuse substances as a way of dealing with the symptoms of trauma, and it's pretty typical for kids to be high and coming down during their interrogation, and that affects their ability to comprehend as well as their ability to make decisions and answer the questions that they are being asked.
Thank you so much. I wish there were time for questions, but we